Good evening. Oh, is this thing on? Do we have any? Yeah, all right. Good evening. Hello. Welcome to the ASLA Northern California Chapter's second lecture in the 2015 lecture series. My name is Yasmin Farazian. I am one of the directors of the ASLA board this year, so it's great to meet you all. And tonight, before we get started, I'd like to do a little bit of housekeeping for a couple of events that are coming up in the near future. First off, the call for entries and awards deadline is tomorrow. So if you have any projects that you are interested in submitting, please go ahead and do so. The next is that we would like you to mark your calendars for March 19th, which is our next lecture on creative play. We'd love to see you all there. And if you could help spread the word and get other people to come, that would be fantastic. And last but not least, also the please mark your calendars for the awards dinner and presentation on April 16th. Location is to be determined. So we would love to see you all there. Our lecture tonight is, the topic is stormwater design and creativity, and we'll be hearing from Wright Yang, Senior Associate at Hargreaves Associates, and Alan Lewis, Director and Open Space Practice Leader from SOM San Francisco. So without further ado, I'd like to ask for Wright and Alan to please join me. Thank you. Thanks.
Thanks. Good to see everybody that I know and all of you that I don't know. What I was really excited about when asked to do this lecture again was that Wright and I and a handful of other people had an incredible experience that was incredibly unique in that we were asked to, on the spur of the moment, go to Beijing, interview with the mayor for a concept design project that was going to take 4 months. 4 years later, we ended up building a 100-acre park on a riverfront, and we essentially were able to guide and lead a client that wanted the best thing that they could have, and they put this incredible amount of trust into two strappy kids, and we ended up with, you know, what could be the projects of our life and of our career. During this time, Wright and I, of course, got very close, so I thought that we should just present in Mandarin since most of the audience is Chinese, it looks like. Yeah, you will by the end, yeah. So anyway, the issue of stormwater management was paramount in our approach and was really, no pun intended, a foreign language to the client. Because at that time, it was out of their lexicon of understanding. They just wanted a pretty park. So we were able, through a long process, help to guide them to what we believed in to do the right thing. So, and as you see, now I'm at SOM. I was a principal in charge of this project at Hargreaves for years. And so I was talking to one of the women that were Jisoo, who worked on this project with us, and we were talking about George Hargreaves, and just how much he enjoyed the early part of this project, and it was just really inspiring to, because she was an intern at that time, and how inspirational that was, because he really asked us to do things that we otherwise probably wouldn't have gotten to ourselves, and Wright probably has some clay models hidden away in a closet that he doesn't want to remember, but there was a really positive experience going through those early concept phases. So when she said that, it just really kind of went deep that, you know, it really was this enriching environment. We kind of, Wright, in his normal way, cordoned off a part of the office, and that just became our kind of war room that we did all of this work. So anyway, orthodoxly unorthodox, this was a project that did not follow any conventions. In terms of the process, in terms of the contracting, in terms of project schedule, project budget, we had an incredible LDI that were average age of probably 27, something like that, that were these young professionals that wanted to learn all they could, and they did an outstanding job all the way through every phase of the project. So they deserve, and it changed their lives, this whole experience. So let me just run through some of the early parts of the work and then some of the ideas about the transformation that happened. This was the site. It was a coal and gravel storage staging area along the Haihe River in Tonggu, and a lot of shipbuilding and ship repair. The image to the lower right is actually the peninsula that showed how the river had been sectioned off by each of the European shipping companies, and each one had their port before goods went upriver to Tianjin and then got on trains that went to Beijing or the northern part. So the area had been severely impacted for well over 100 years, and this port, Tonggu, was actually the site of the World War II surrender of Chinese to the Japanese. So it was historically a really important geographic position on the connection of northern China to the ocean. The other bit was in the upper right-hand side was the soda ash plant. Soda ash was invented, and the largest soda ash plant on the planet was here. And when we first started going there, everything was covered with the film of soda ash, which is a admixture to make plastics and glass stronger, but incredibly toxic. So the soil was incredibly challenged. And when we got there, the client wanted us to make this riverfront, that space, their central park. And it was, he's a mayor, you just do it, okay, give us a central park. And so we said, okay. My first site visit was this. The site had been remediated, and they were now starting to do the rough grading for the overall district, which was about 2 miles long by a half a mile deep, and it was just filled with cars and dump trucks and just complete insanity. The traffic on this area, there was nobody managing anything. People were just doing their work on top of everyone else. This is the peninsula. The bay is about a half a mile to the right down river, and this peninsula, which is Ujaipu, SOM did the master plan for it, and the high-speed rail from Beijing into here, and our site is over here, and currently now I believe Arup did the train station, and now Big is doing four of the towers, and Diller and Scafidio is going to be doing a museum. So all of a sudden, this is a new kind of hot spot. And literally, when we first got there, there was nothing except those trucks. So we did. So that phone call ended up being a 20-kilometer riverfront concept design, and it also then started to relate to the connectivity with the urban framework that had been set up. And so one of the big pieces was, how does this park integrate both sides of the river and become a destination as well as that central park? So this is the site area, and that was something. So one of the first steps that we took was the typical riverfront in China. The levee and the seawall are pushed to the water's edge, and that anticipates the worst storm events. And so in this case, the top of the levee, if you will, is approximately 12 feet or so above mean normal water level. So you put that 12-foot embankment upright at the river, then nobody in the park can see the river. So our first move was to pull that protective barrier back to the urban edge and then let the landscape flow down to the river, so that you could, when you were standing on the road, From there, the levee was 1 meter up, so you could see over it and see another 100 yards and see the water. So that was one of the primary fundamental organizing principles. And what we did was we made that levee line the promenade. And this is a view of that promenade with program gardens on the urban side, and then less programming and more natural conditions as it went down to the river. And so that piece of infrastructure, which I view very much as stormwater management because that's when you get the floods. So flood control was one of the key elements that ran through the entire project. So the project essentially was about a mile and a half long, and it went from a northern, more urban, and more programmed zone to the south, which was a less programmed, more natural riparian network. So again, along the promenade, the earlier one was up in the more programmed zone, whereas the southern one was more where we reintroduced the indigenous forest and also then the indigenous flooding ecologies of the river. So that southern zone is here, and you see, like, again, when I first got there, when we first arrived, none of those buildings were there. It's 4 years, 4.5 years later. They're all there. They're all occupied. And now the park is built, and one of the things that we instigated was do the park early because the property values will go up. You will get this almost immediate. It's just like your backyard, you know. Forget renovating the kitchen. Put a garden and a patio in, and you'll feel better, right? So essentially, the organization of the project is, the high promenade, which runs the length of it, and then there's a series of different kinds of park typologies that engage with the river. And one of the things we wanted to do was on the land side of that levee, the land side of the promenade, was to create immediate destinations for that urban fabric, so that there was a linear park system that people working in the towers, et cetera, or lived in the residences could go across the street and be in a park without committing to going all the way to the edge of the river to the promenade. They could just go to the top of the promenade, which was 100 feet away, as opposed to 100 yards away, and engage with the river and the layers of ecology between them. So this is the built work from about a year ago, and we're looking at the northern edge. And it went from, in the previous drawing, those panels, it went from a much more programmed urban edge. This is the site for one of the signature towers to the north, or a series of hotels, museums, public destinations. Then there was a series of botanical forests that then met with the central plaza that linked back to another signature tower piece, and there's a small park in here that we also did. And then there's a ferry stop out here. And then it moved into more of a series of forest hills and flooding meadows that was then lined with operative working wetland to manage the water coming off of that portion of the park. And then it went down all the way down to the temple site. There's a historic Buddhist temple that was built in or established in 1509, and it's claimed to be the oldest operating temple in northern China still. So it's it's the one relic, because everything else had been eliminated, but the one little temple was still there. So one of the big issues was that at this point around the bend, the river, as it bent around, far in before it swung back out. So one of the things that we did was we created a series of platters or platforms that extended out over the river, but the river was allowed to continue flowing, so we didn't interfere with the water volume capacity of the river system. And so this was, of course, when you got the mayor and the regional planning director on your side, you're able to kind of get some things done. So this is that northern edge, and you see, again, the we were able to bring the forest right to the city edge. And so these mixed forests as well as these forest plazas provided that richness of bringing that Central Park idea right to the edge of the city. And then we had a series of botanical gardens and program destination pieces, restaurants, cafes, paddle boat basin, model boat basin, ice skating rinks, etc. And so initially we had tried to put a lot of that program into the land and then came up working with the locals about how we could build this structure out over the river. And here you see an early schematic enlargement of that. And the red line is actually the seawall. So that's the edge of land and water. And so again, trying to blur that edge between one where the city starts, where the park starts, what floods, what doesn't flood, how the park extends out over the river. So this is the kind of early section on that, where the existing seawall is here. We allow the river on its normal day-to-day basis flow underneath this artificial platform that then has either paddle boat basins or water gardens or plazas extending out over it. The dashed blue line is flood level. So this is all designed to take flooding, to be there during the flood and not say, if this area floods, you can't be in it. So this is a very approach of finding those overlaps where we can work and allow nature to do its thing, but we can also engage in a unique manner. It was a beautiful sight when we got there. You see the seawall, you see the river, and you see the scale of the river, and you see this kind of flooding, just ruined condition because the salt water, heavy salt water, and high water table made the planting scenario quite a challenge. And so we were able, by extending out, to create a direct relationship with the water, being over the water. And as you go around the paddle boat basin, which is roughly an acre, you're literally on a walkway that's the width of one of these. And so you're out in the river, walking for a couple hundred yards around, out on top of the river. So it's a really incredible sensation, living in this incredibly dense urban environment, to all of a sudden be like the only person out on this walkway. So and these are a lot of surprises. This railing system, as an architect, was one of the most challenging things to produce. And I'll mention the issue about our approach from the beginning was to work within the construction limitations of the client and the construction teams that were going to be on the site. We're not doing a lot of shop drawings and prefabrication and mock-ups of stainless steel and all kinds of gusset plates. And we needed something that folks that are usually building with bricks and sticks and pouring concrete and planting trees could do without us being there, you know, barking at contractors and spending tons of money, not getting what we want, right? You guys have been there, I'm sure. So what we developed was a very panelized system, very simple, that literally two people could hold and secure in place and unify that long edge. And what was interesting about it was the fact that you could see through it at times, but then it became opaque at times. It became a solid surface, but then as you moved around it and the way light reflected and the issues of water reflecting on those curved surfaces was actually fantastic. A clear day in Beijing. But what was amazing is all of a sudden we have people arriving on the site. You know, and this is a construction site that really didn't have a gate. It was just kind of being done, so people just arrived. Long before the park opened. And this is the paddle boat basin partway, and that's the bridge I was I was speaking about. These are some of the LDI folks, these mature youngsters. When that paddle boat basin was being framed up, it was one of the most amazing. It was like being in some antiquity site, because you just saw the concrete frame, an acre large, just with no, like, why is it there? So as we move a little bit further south, they also, you know, kind of at the end, oh, we need a marina. Can you do a marina? So we did a marina. They didn't have any boats, but so one of the big issues was about layering, and you can see it really well in this image from the Haihe Road through the kind of Forest Plaza zone, the promenade. And then we went from the kind of signature gardens to signature forest, so that these strands, so that when you're on the promenade, you're kind of always looking across layers of species, and you see these bands. And all of the species are regional species, so there's no, foreign. These are all northern China species that are hardy enough to deal with an incredibly cold, incredibly dry winter, and incredibly wet summer. And so this northern portion was really thought of kind of as a farm, kind of as an orchard. But again, to be able to see this almost in a didactic manner, the layering of these different species. So it wasn't about decorating, it was really about presenting, right? So again, the kind of layering. So that was carried through to the next level, which are really the forests. And in this, because we had this giant bridge that was crossing, right, might start to get squeezy in this model, was incredibly strong element that we wanted to connect the two sides so that we had a system that was able to flow underneath it. And we had a very, very shallow site. So we wanted to build the soil up, but we didn't want to block the views. You can see the section at the top. So we created this what we called the washboard, where we had a series of ridges and ravines that then the paths that occurred sometimes in between, you could see over the ridge, you could see to the next layer. The back sides, the steeper sides, were planted with ground cover or low bushes, and then the trees were planted on the more shallow slope, and so they begin to run again in kind of monospecies bands, so that you were able to look through those layers of forests and layers of species over those ridges. And what that allowed us to do was get deeper soil above the level of the bad water table. So that kind of seaming under the bridge and that fabric of those gardens, and you can see the promenade at the edge, the water's edge, and then the ridges. And here's a view from the bridge looking at these places that literally in this dense urban environment, you can get lost on these walkways and find a certain kind of solitude along these lower trails. And these were also designed to transfer the water, okay? So these little gravel trails were also these programmatically very interesting to get lost in there. And one of the things that, of course, we would have these presentations with the mayor, and every presentation there would be a whole new group of people that we didn't know, and they would start asking, why can't you go from the promenade to the river? You need more paths across there. You need more paths across there. We want to go from the promenade to the river. And we're like, no. It's not about that. There are places to do that and places not to do that. So we had to really hold our ground on a lot of these conditions. And as the, part of the issue, of course, is that these environments go through the seasons. They change color. You guys all know this. They change color. The structure and color of the bark and the structures of the plants themselves, they still have that. You see those layers. You see that display of the planting materials all the way through. So moving to the southern end, you can see where they're building the next bridge. I'm sure it's done and up and running. We're still trying to get ours to work. This was more of the idea of, again, there was a presentation idea, but there was this weaving together of the upper promenade and the lower promenade, and this clay model starts to present some of that. With the, again, the forested edge, the promenade, and then a series of raised landforms which each had its own species of trees. So these big tables were kind of thought of as platters that tilted up towards the promenade so that as you go by, you see the ground surface sloping away and you see a monospecies forest. Then you get these breaks that allow you to see out and see the river as well as the back ridges of what we call the open meadow. So we had a language of open meadow and raised lawn or raised forest that started to undulate and create this spatial dynamic. And Le Corbusier said the best parts of his projects were the ones he didn't anticipate. And walking, I actually got to ride a bicycle through the site one day. This intermediate trail, undulating between seeing the river, being tucked in these landforms, seeing the river, seeing the promenade, was really a beautiful kind of sequence. Or you could be on the upper promenade, or you could be on the lower promenade, but that was a really spatially dynamic. Now, all that stuff is great, but why we're here today is to talk kind of about water. And I'll give all the credit to Wright. I did a couple of drawings, but Wright figured it all out and, you know, challenged us the whole way. So here you see the promenade. Here you see one of the landform forests. Here you see one of the meadows. And so the idea was that we could use this sculpting of land to take all of the water that was on the riverside and direct it down to lower basins that then would be able to go down. And this was a temporary thing on construction sites where you kind of freak out when you get there. We didn't draw that. This is some tropical garden that they put in because of a mayor's opening event. But we have a whole series of wetlands within that water would flow into those wetlands, and there's a staging that I'll show you here in a minute. So the spatial ideas, the planting ideas, working with the soils, but the water was a key element. Now this is a place where they get about 2 feet of rain a year, and it happens in about 6 weeks. And the rest of the time, it's cold and arid and dry. Or arid and dry are the same thing. So here you start to see kind of part of that system. This is a, you also see the ferry stop. I think Wright designed this while watching an NBA playoff game, I think, was about when that happened. It happened that quick. We'd do a drawing, we'd send it to them, and the next thing we'd do is we'd get some LDIs, you know, drawings of it, and we're going to build it next week. Is it okay? You know, but really amazing kind of process. We had some things happen, of course, we didn't like very much. But this we really liked. So the upper image is what was there when we got there. And the lower image is what we had been selling them on, a working riparian riverfront. So here you can start to see the patterns of the water flow, how directed around the landforms, around the meadows, to the basins, overflowing into the wetland and then being released back into the water. So those of you that have been to China, those of you that have been to Beijing, you know what water is. So it was really amazing to think about rain going through this park, being cleaned, and being released into the river cleaner than when it hit the ground. That's like a huge success for me. I feel good about that, right? I think it's, and it also, what's even greater is that it's a demonstration. And the mayor from Beijing is here. The governor of the region comes to see this park. And these are the things that the local mayor and the local planning commission talks about as exemplary. And it's not about, you know, me and Wright and Hargreaves. It's about what we've been able to show them, what they learned from the earlier time when just make it pretty. Just make it pretty, you know, is what, well, that's what the translation always was. So some of those meetings, this mayor, he would be slamming his fist and yelling, and Naife, the translator, he likes it. And I'm like, wait, this doesn't, you know. So those ideas, of course, you know, for those of you that know what pens and paper are, you know, that's how we worked it out. And the amount of effort that we went through to get things to work first, to then get it documented, to then translate it to the locals was really incredible. So this is just a little microcosm. This is the dry season where we've been able to create those lower basins and also been in the wetlands, having an outer kind of ridge that has a lower point in it, so that as we get that initial rain, that then the upper basin and lower basin start to take water. Then, of course, they get the wetter condition, and then they get the worst condition, but then it's designed to be released back in. And the whole time, being able to let the low promenade move over that water transference so that people can actually see that thing operating and that thing performing. And this is probably that sort of thing right here, where in that dense urban environment where you have all of this stuff happening, that we were able to leave the site with something that may outlive us. And it was incredible walking through this environment or riding the bike through, and there's birds and there's frogs and my gosh, and it's amazing, right? So that was a very unique situation. Thank you. And I'll let Wright tell you the real story.
The good thing about working with Alan is that he will just lay down all this groundwork and I can just finish it very quickly. That's right. Hi everybody, I'm Wright, and today I'm gonna focus on the second part of the presentation very quickly, mainly on how to address the stormwater management issue in northern China by working with the landscape typologies as well as the planting materials. This is the simple diagram that kind of guides us through most of our design effort in the office. It's about focusing on the design effort on working with the particular site of the project and how to make it memorable at the same time to enhance the performance of the park or the landscape. So we have done a lot of large landscape like this throughout the world, in Sydney Olympic in Australia, Chrissy Field, San Francisco, of course, and the most recent 2012 London Olympic as well. So this will be the first large-scale built waterfront project by Hargreaves. And to try to understand and address this critical issue around the world, especially in this part of the world, was quite important. So when I first got invited to talk about stormwater management, as Alan mentioned earlier, they kind of have the similar climate as DC because they're on the same latitude, but at the same time, they only have the rainfall about 21 inches like Los Angeles, and in a very short amount of time of the year. It's very little water if you really think about it. So when I start to organize this PowerPoint, I ask myself, what's stormwater? As we all know, most of the water situation is very severe in terms of shortage in this part of the world. And most of the time, they suffer from the drought condition in the northern China. And the flood most likely occurred on the southern part of China. But if we look back, you can see the drought actually occurs in different part of China in recent years. And all this has a dramatic impact on people's life as well as the croplands that support tremendous amount of people domestically and internationally. And with all of those productive landscape actually compete with all the water resource that they have, which is not much, they have severe shortage on the water availabilities. So if we take a closer look of the region, in this region you have the high desert on the west side of the mountain, and then you have the mountain ridge and the plain and the delta into the sea. And because the drought is so severe, it very often accompanied with the very severe and very frequent sandstorm in the area, it's rough estimate about 1 million ton of sand blow into the city of Beijing annually. And along with that, all the smog that was, all the pollution was generated by all the industrial activities in the region as well as all the traffic from the city. When we were start going there in 2010, the driver told us there are about 1,000 new cars hitting the road every single day. So sounds like pretty memorable landscape for me so far. So because all of the stuff that we just talked about, the government has deployed a large amount of major ecosystem service try to address some of the various critical issue they have in hand, from building this miles of great green walls to fight back the ever-expanding desert ecologies outside of the city, as well as inside the city. You know, this is one of the historic stream that used to run through the city, but it has been channelized into this concrete, solid concrete basin that has very little water in that. And the water is so, they have so little water, they have to divert a lot of water resource from the south all the way to China, try to alleviate the pressure of the water shortage. So if you put all this waterway together, this project is so big, it will stretch from Boston all the way to Caracas or from London all the way to Istanbul. So, of course, you know, there must, but on the other hand, in July 21st, 2012, which is, I think, shortly after our trip, Beijing received the heaviest rain in the past 61 years that overloaded entire aging, insufficient urban infrastructure of the modern city of Beijing that we all know about, the high-rise, the image of high-rise and high-speed railroad. So the empty concrete channel that you just saw, it turned into this giant water conveyance that transport this flood water from point A to point B in the rapid speed, which does not help in terms of the stormwater management at all, of course. So are we just gonna jump into the conclusion to blend to the climate change again? Perhaps not. Maybe we should look at what we have done to our stream system in the more general practice global level. In many places, of course in China as well, on the upper stream we have a very severe deforestation situation that severely damage the water holding capacity on the upper stream. And that also the diminishing forest coverage, especially this part in a deciduous temperate broadleaf forest, also play a huge part in terms of helping managing the stormwater on the upper stream. On the lower stream, which where the marsh supposed to be, has been replaced by this giant seawall that you can see in many parts of the Chinese coastline. And if you look at the majority of the Chinese coastline in the red, and the yellow is the gray wall that they had built thousands of years ago. This is another giant major infrastructure that they try to put in. The number is staggering and it's changed a lot of coastline ecology as well. So, back to the stormwater management, in order to have a comprehensive picture of this, we really cannot not to look at the entire river basin in a more cohesive ways. And because just simply because our site, the red dot right over there, is actually where the entire basin drained to into the Gulf. And this entire river system has been developed on focused on the transportation and irrigation purpose for hundreds of years. What we have left from the upstream and the downstream in the middle is this more than 50 million people metropolitan area from Beijing to Tianjin, as well as the vast agricultural land that competing for the water. With all of these, the aquifer system is also severely declined since 1960s. So what we have left, or what we gave ourselves, is this complex hydrology system that is so heavily engineered, is actually the second most engineered river basin per 100 kilometer of river in the world. And all this waterway has lost all the capacity of all the environmental capacity, which was shown on the diagram on the right. So the Haihe River, this is what it looks like in Tianjin about 17th century, and this is what it looks like today. As you can see, the hard concrete edge provide very little, if almost none, of ecological river ecology benefit. And few miles down the stream where our site is, you can see this vast brownfield that is eager to be transformed into this new shining city on the riverfront that compete with the world, the best city in the world. However, you can see thousands of dead fish sometimes occur in the river because of all the issues we just talked about. So stormwater management. What we have left here is a management system that usually will be in place after the storm event has occurred. None of these is the things that a client actually want to hear when we first start working. All they are interested in is how we can help them to build this contemporary, modern, urban waterfront to address this beautiful city they're gonna have. They will strengthen the economic corridor from Beijing all the way to Tianjin and to the coastline. So this is the 10 kilometer that Alan just mentioned earlier. So when we start looking at, we realize once upon a time, this is the landscape used to look like. And now is this desolate, vast brownfield that has the new urban grid overlay on top of it. So the first flood control issue need to be taken care of. So we look at the existing flood zone and the levee condition that Alan just mentioned. And all this, what the upper promenade, the levee has done as well, is it divide into two watersheds, if you will. One is into the one that into the city, and the one that is outside the levee that into the park and into the river. So all these things will be able to connect and into the urban street grid, as well as providing all the surface node in this linear zone that be able to also address the stormwater issue along the edge of the park, as well as the adjacent block. So outside of the levee, you will experience various different type of landscape programming characters that in company with the landscape, different landscape typologies and the planting typologies, and all of these will be connect by the lower promenade that take people in and out closer to the river. And all the lower promenade also change from softscape to hardscape through different through various conditions. So this is the river park. So the design vision was clear, established by working with the client group. And it's the park that is actually it's the first park that mainly softscape along the entire Haihe River. And this is the first one in this scale. So what they want a big urban forest, has a lot of urban parks in there, and also a lot of urban gardens. So I'm gonna introduce the very quickly the some of the landscape type and how we work with the typology to do the stormwater management. So this is 1.5 mile, same scale compared to Chrissy Field, and it's about two-thirds of the length of the Central Park. And one of the biggest challenge to build a build a forest in this location, as Alan just mentioned, is the high groundwater table, as well as the alkaline soil. And the groundwater table is brackish water, part of it, slightly. So the root ball has to stay at a certain elevation in order to survive. And the idea of connecting people back to their land through the landscape they are familiar with within the region was a genuine design intent. Therefore, we study very carefully about the ecology within the region that we just mentioned earlier and try to find the best fit of the way to bring back the planting community to create the appropriate ecology in the park. So the first type of urban forest is the upland forest and the meadow that Alan mentioned earlier on the south. So there are some technical issues that we have to address, such as the underdrain system and the rough grading and planting soil to allow adequate planting soil for the trees. And along with that, it also helps to direct the stormwater in the way that Alan just mentioned. They will be able to collect and clean and eventually discharge into the river. And this part of the forest mainly are the mixed forests to encourage the biodiversities, but also with those three oval-shaped monoculture forests try to highlight and display the beauty of the local indigenous plants. So this is what it looks like as you walk inside those paths that Alan just mentioned earlier. So the water drains back towards Upper Promenade before it goes back towards the river. And as you walk along the promenade, on the Upper Promenade, sometimes you will see this very intimate forest trail that invites you to walk into a piece of forest. And as you walk into it, you will find yourself in the environment like this. And as you look back through the all these sticks, you will see a little vignette of the city, the park you just walked through, the wetland and the river and the city beyond. So the second type is the botanical forest that Alan also mentioned about. So with all those environmental issues, the government tried to put a lot of efforts to do the reforestation and also the agroforestry to try to green the city as well as the major infrastructure corridor. But what they have done here is create this very benign but impressive landscape that has a very interesting and good quality of the space that you will never be able to experience as a pedestrian. So what we have done, as previously mentioned, is throughout this washboard ideas to be able to direct the water in the more shallower slope and longer way to encourage the more infiltrations. And one of the side story happened is before we got there, actually there was a previous project that was built by other consultants that got shut down halfway constructed. And the client has asked us to salvage the canal that was abandoned from the scheme and to utilize to transform them into the underground system that allows some of the stormwater can be stored underneath there. So when it comes to making an instant forest, they are very serious and very good at it, as you can see from the size of the tree that it brought in. And the other things on the ground cover is that you will see this kind of intercropping practice very common in the nurseries, which we also try to incorporate. And all this stormwater management gesture has been not only highlighted during the daytime, but also during the night through the planting, through the lighting design as well. So the third type is the botanical garden. And instead of focusing on engage any kind of traditional Chinese garden or landscape elements, what we're trying to focus on is how we, by working with the planting materials, how we can actually reconnect the people back to the landscape. And these are some of the grading strategy that has been mentioned earlier. So this is this fall. So along the waterfront, there are two major components. The north is the water plaza that with all these different water programs, whether it's the boardwalk, the interactive fountain, the multiple basin, the pedalable basin, and people start to engage and really loving it. So the last part is the seasonal wetland, you know, just like all the green roof that we try to do most of the time. It sounds good in the PR, but usually it's the first thing to go. So it's actually, we were very pleased and surprised that we actually be able to get that part done the way that it was constructed. By manipulating the sectional profile that allow us to bring back the planting, different planting community to form the ecologies that we try to establish. These are some of the earlier photos. That guy looks familiar, right? So you can see like all these layers of planting not only occurs on the trees, but also on the, also addressed on the ground planting. And as you walk around the park and look around the park, it's really, sometimes the picture just doesn't justify the experience. Oops. So this. There's some background noise, I can turn it on if it helps, but. Yeah, you have to pay extra money for that. That's all it takes, yeah. So I think this leads to the conclusion, the last part of the presentation about the stormwater creativities. Perhaps, I'm not sure that what we talk about today is that new or, you know, innovative compared to all the knowledge that we have now and learned about our environment today. I think for me, the whole process is more of a revelation that maybe the creativity is within finding the way of connecting the dots together in our environment, whether it's working in the studio in the San Francisco or working with the government official on the other part of the world, or working with the local construction team or the local design teams and other consultants. And the creativity is also maybe found in coordinating the issues on the drawings as well as in the field. And we were very lucky to have 18 trips. We were very fortunate to have 18 trips for both of us together to go over there to facilitate this whole process. And the connection that we was be able to establish with the local people that keep us informed almost on a weekly basis throughout the entire process, which is also pretty remarkable. And in the past 20 years, the entire region has been transformed from the image on the left to the image to the right. And through this time, the site also changed from this to today, the park that we have known and we draw. We also live in a time from lost in translation to today's Google translation. And we can do so many things so much quicker, faster, and more accurate. Or do we? So with that, with just right amount of imagination, I believe that we can restore the landscape like this to become something like this. So I'm gonna end it with this quote. Thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Wright. And at this time, we have a few minutes for some questions. If there are any questions, we've got quite a few. So I would like to ask Alan and Wright to come back up, and we can take some of those.
We have rain that actually we can see the system is working. I am.
Yeah. No, nobody believes it. And then, I think it was Leon Freer that said, you can tell them and they'll hate you because they don't believe it, and then they'll hate you because it happened.
Yeah,
yeah,
you were right.
Yeah, and you were right. Yeah. So we haven't had the, because it's a locked river, you know, and managed, even in the torrential flooding that they had, they didn't have the past 2 years, they didn't have the big ones where they had to open up the locks to allow the actual park to flood, but the wetlands have flooded, have filled up, have flowed back into the river, so that's...
So you don't hope for a big flood, but it would be interesting to see how
Yeah, you probably will see a lot of other important stuff on the news before you see the news about a park got flooded. We'd love to go back.
Yeah,
I would.
We'll get back. The other thing is the relationship that we have with so many people. We get constant, you know, feeds about what's happening. Alphabetical, I have no idea.
I have so many questions. My God, I don't know like where to begin.
Well, you know how to find me.
We would still be in permitting.
Other than the technical question, though, I do have like a general overview. Like, I'm curious about because we are expecting.
We are not in any relationship. If that's the question you're gonna ask.
We're like in a very interesting timing because awareness of the voting type of development. The flood control and everything is about to start. So if you arrive at the right time, it actually become very influential in the process. So very soon, these rules, typically taken care of by engineers, will still be taken care of by
committee and actually had the opportunity to meet and present to the Shanghai Land Commissioner and Planning Director. And there are, you know, one of the things that's happened, of course, has happened in the last, really in the last 10 years, is that many people like yourself have come to the States or gone to Europe and become trained, gone back to China, started firms, started good firms or work in good firms that are helping to push those issues, and or people going back and being part of the city government or city planning to bring that knowledge back. And again, it's all through the proper example. In the last 5 years or since the new president, where now it's not that each individual or within the government is evaluated by how much financial business they've been able to do. One of the checkpoints is how have you brought sustainability into your projects. And so I think it is it's a generational thing, and the next generation is very concerned about it because they're living through these floods, they're living through pollution like has never been recorded before. And so I think a lot of it is awareness. So I'm hopeful, right? Otherwise, let's just go home, right? But I do think that through demonstration, and it's not just that, oh, they're doing it in Holland, right? Is that it's actually happening in China. It's actually happening outside of Beijing. Turinscape is doing some great projects that address all of these issues. So I think that it is, they're becoming more aware and more educated, and it's probably becoming much more available to them. So that, just like here, I've never argued with an engineer about anything. But, you know, constantly. Because they're doing their job, you're doing your job, and you're trying to, you know, manage to make the right choice. We, of course, had a lot of pushback from the hydrologists and the civil engineering about what we were trying to do. You can't do that. You build a seawall. You can slope the embankment. You're not going to put plants out there. They'll never grow. Right? So I think through example is the best way to lead.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He's
right,
picking.
You mentioned that people engaged in real estate showed a picture of an elderly person picking flowers or something. But in what way do people in the community, in what way do they actually engage with?
Yeah, well, yeah, thanks for the question. I think, you know, it's a great question. Because actually, you know, it's kind of tied back to the aerial photo of that giant, benign green corridor up on both sides. Like, it's just so overwhelming without a sense of purpose. Well, the purpose is very clear, but it has nothing to do with the visitors. And people just drive past by them, they just know there's some green, and they have no interest, no interest of like knowing anything furthermore. And interesting enough, most of the construction crew on site is actually farmers. And the way that they take care of each planting materials from the installation to the maintenance and everything, it's like it's almost like a life theater, if you will. Like those kind of care you will never see like in the construction activity here towards the planting materials. So I think the other thing is like the way that we talk about it, how we arrange the planting materials instead of like just kind of like dress them up for the space, we actually try to display them in a way that is more didactic and more educational. So as you walk through them, the visual interests will be able to evoke the desire and to learn more about it. And actually part of our extra service is try to create all this informational display exhibit, whether it's the tree plate, or like about how the system works. A lot of this system, actually, we have it engraved on a 6-foot long piece of stone that plays throughout the park to describe how this park is working every single day. And through that, to kind of like, to help people to like reestablish their connections, if they answer your questions.
Well, they learn.
Yes.
But do they work? You know, one thing once it's installed and it's established, but you know, can people go there, pick things, plant things, do things?
Plant things, probably not.
You know, the first step was hitting them off the don't step on the critter. And that, you know, conventionally, landscape architects come in and kind of decorate an environment with plants in China. They haven't gotten into kind of some of the layers of the interpretive programming. They also huge on, well, everything should be symmetrical, things should be placed in a certain way, and, you know, 9 times out of 10 people will say, oh, it's feng shui, and then you say, like, how? And then they're like, oh, no, you know, it just is, and so I think a lot of it was that we were able to present a different way to engage with one, the sculpting of the land, two, the plant materials, to be able to walk along a path in the middle of a garden as opposed to it being a formal processional element. So a lot of that had to do with promoting and allowing that, because we got into a lot of issues with, well, those meadows, you're not going to let people walk on the grass. We're like, no. People should be walking on the grass. They should feel the grass. They should be able to sit on the grass. And they came around to that through, again, us showing examples of how it happens in Bryant Park. It happens in Central Park. It happens, and they're like, well, it doesn't happen in China. And we're like, well, it can. And so that was where there were kind of that, these cultural leaps. And, you know, again, a huge amount of the population has now seen and been to other parts of the world and come back, and so they need that. And the middle part of the peninsula is all designed as an international headquarter complex. So they're anticipating that Tangu will have a huge foreign population, and they'll want to experience parks in a manner that you might in South America or Europe or the US. So I think there is a, you know, but again, it's a small step, but I think it's a big small step. But no interactive, you know, farming, and, you know, you don't want anything to come out of that soil.
Interactive irrigation.
Yeah, we got rid of the interactive irrigation. Sorry. The answer should.
I was curious, you had this fascinating diagram about how much of the coastal land in China has been turned into a park over the time, and obviously it's a minuscule portion, but have you found this project to be being used as a model among other municipalities and municipalities in the country to help the
coastal area? We're doing that.
Okay, good.
We're doing that, and again, like I said, you know, they've had huge you know, fleets of dignitaries come through. And the mayor is showing this thing off, because of course it's his retirement package. but yeah, and everybody is incredibly ecstatic about it, and they just can't believe it. You know, so that's rewarding. I think one more question.
Sure. Okay, one more question.
Is it true that everything's on off and all, or is it just don't want to?
No, we don't. We had many programs to help to do that, but it's just like the portion of the canal that we retained that they never put a pump in. It's a giant cistern. It could hold a lot of water, but they chose not to. No, everything on the land side goes into the urban infrastructure. Everything on the river side goes into the river. Yeah, very much. Right.
it's a different ecology because historically the water wouldn't be that, one, it wouldn't be that saline, and two, it wouldn't be that polluted. And three, it probably wouldn't be that high because it, yeah, in a way it is new. Well, it's artificial. Let's just, man has been there, it's artificial.
Well, what kind of storm do you think you can handle, a year of storm?
We work with Sherwood Engineering in San Francisco, and in the early process, we do use the number of 100-year storm data as kind of a benchmark to work against, and you know, and then that's kind of the, because a lot of like real data is very hard to get out of the government for whatever reason it might be. So we kind of, based on all we know and then the stuff that we can piece together, we kind of just use that and as a guiding principle to work through the process.
Mm-hmm. There's actually two numbers. One is the design flood level. And the second is the design to flood level, and they're two different things.
Mm-hmm.
So the upper promenade is the worst case scenario with levees breaking and upriver, or locks breaking upriver.
Yeah.
And the low promenade is to the design flood level.
Yeah.
So that elevation of the 3.5, which is essentially 2.5 meters above the river, everything below that, so that the boardwalks, the paddle boat basins, the wetlands, etc., could take that kind of water within the low promenade still being above that.
Mm-hmm.
That's assuming no infrastructure upstream fails.
Yeah.
Which, you know how that is.
Exactly.
I lived in New Orleans during the training, but I'm a big believer in water. It's not a problem in China. No. The idea was just build as